Super, fantastic. The first proof, the first printed proof, and it's okay. We're gonna send it to print 100 copies to begin with.
Okay.
So, and what's the back like? What's the back of the book like, Dallas?
Yaka.
No, the back. Okay, a little bit more yellow. Even more hopeful. All right.
Wait.
Okay, Oliver Joyce Mandela.
Wait.
Okay, this.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Super.
Good.
Now we will go and see Vivienne Dick's film about New York, her friends from the 70s, Bohemia. Yeah, she filmed in the 70s and she also filmed in I think like 2020, and we might be able to capture her as well.
Yeah?
Yeah.
All right, I'm here. See you.
Yeah.
She's at heart. we see them happening in New York, a lot of things here, or Dublin, or Manchester, or any other major city in the world, really. So there is an important conversation to be had about that, I think, and I hope that we can do that this evening. Without further ado, please enjoy New York Archive.
Fantastic to be here with Vivienne. Thank you so much for being here. What a fantastic film. I mean, just, you know, thank you again for showing up at the Irish Film London, the UK premiere. Vivienne, I'll start with the obvious question. How did this come about? This is your first documentary. Why a documentary?
No,
why now?
Lots of documentaries, but they were shorter.
Yes, first feature film. Yeah.
Well, it's because of the money. I mean, I applied for a real arts scheme, which is an arts council scheme, for a feature. Well, it doesn't actually have to be feature length work, but the budget's bigger than anything I would have had before. It would be, like, in real terms, a kind of medium budget, even small. People who make documentaries regularly would call it small. But for me, you know, I didn't have the time before I was teaching. And then when I finished teaching, I said to myself, I think I might have a go at this. I didn't want to apply for it until I really knew there was something I wanted to make. Because if you set out to make a film, it takes so much work. Like, you're in for it. It's 2 years, you know, and every day working. So you need to be sure that you want to make something when you apply for funding. That it's Arts Council funded, which is a fantastic thing, because they just let you go at it. You know, that they don't look over your shoulder and kind of tell you have to change this or that. They don't do that.
Was this your first time working with the production crew in that way? I mean, you've made documentaries before, but...
I made short films with crews before, you know, larger crews than usual. But again, I had the budget, so I was able to expand a little bit and, you know, hire in lighting and that sort of thing. So, but this would have been, well, this is a longer film for sure. And, you know, going to America to do it was kind of, you know, it's a smaller budget. I mean, I just went there for a week to sort of do a recce and then went over to shoot for 1 week, came back for a couple of weeks and then back over again for the last week. So it's two-week shoots. So you don't really have a lot of leeway there. You know, you have to be really ready to go as soon as you land off that plane, you know. And you can't do anything else except to concentrate on the film, of course, obviously. So, yeah.
So you mentioned last night Vivienne's film, for those of you who don't know, won our documentary award. And Vivienne very kindly sent us a video message, and you talked a little bit about the editing process. Mm. You said you and you very kindly name checked a lot of the people you worked on the film with, you know, and really bring it home to people, I think, in the audience last night, how collaborative filmmaking process is. And you edited for 10 months, is that correct?
Well, we started about August and by the end of January, you know, festival in Dublin, and then as soon as the film was shown, a couple of days later, full lockdown, so we were very lucky to get it out at all.
Ooh.
For a viewing, because lockdown was completely dead everywhere. There were no cinemas, of course, open. Yeah.
So has that had an impact in the screenings?
Of course, absolutely. Yeah. It was very reluctant to put it online, because it's just such a horrible... You know, you made this film, it's meant for the screen, and it's such a great soundtrack and everything. It's miserable to have, you know, just to be watching it on a television or an iPad or something, you know, so.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. It's a film that needs to be seen in the cinema.
Oh, it gets more screens than anything.
Absolutely.
Spread the word, please. I'm thinking about its cinematic qualities. I was really stuck and watched it again.
the opening section of the film, and that motif is revisited throughout the film. The beautiful setting of Manhattan, almost as an alien universe. Would you like to tell us a little bit about how that came about, or did that come out in the editing process?
No, that was in my mind. That was definitely planned. You're talking to people and you have these interviews, you're in people's apartments, etc. And I used this going up the stairs as a kind of a transition thing as well. And I thought that Manhattan's so busy and there's so much stuff, you know, and there's so many, it's just hard to kind of almost see, you know. So I thought I wanted to say something with these abstract kind of buildings, you know, and the orange filter to make it more abstract so that it starts to say something else. It's something about, you know, it's something about time, and what time is this? Because you look at some of the older buildings that were built in the 20s and 30s, and some of them are extraordinary, you know, they look like something from Egypt, Babylon, you know, very imaginary kind of buildings that you'd have in a science fiction movie, you know, as you saw. And then the new buildings are something else again, the ones that are in the Hudson Yards around there. They're very, you know, glass reflecting, they're very hard, they're very sharp, you know, and no people at all, you can't see through the glass, you know. So of course I deliberately shot it so you couldn't see people for the most part, but yeah, I mean, I was trying to bring in the idea, especially at the end, I was trying to bring in the idea of New York has such an extraordinary history all back through the centuries since it was built. And such a vibrant place with all these people arriving from other places. And the period I was there in the late 70s is like, it's just like this slice of time. So the film is like two slices of time, just that period and now. And with those shots at the end, I'm trying to give the idea of where is all this going? Where is the city going? Where are we going in this, you know, in this world, really? Because in a way, you could look at those buildings and you could say to yourself, well, that could be like Beijing or something. Maybe it's not, you know, you wouldn't know, you know. So that idea, expanding it out a bit, you know. And I really wanted to get that sense of how, I suppose you could say the film is like an ethnographic study of my community when I was there. It's a bit like that, and I'm there in it, and it's from the inside. And, I wanted to have the sense of, our time on the planet is very short. It just goes by. I mean, look at us now, you know. It's just crazy, you know. And I wanted to evoke the energy that was there in the time I was there, with the archive, with the music and everything, to kind of give you a sense of it really was an energetic sort of creative time. You know, I wanted it to be a nostalgic thing. Yeah
and I think it really captured that, and also a sense of continuity through some of the people you interview towards the end, the woman who hangs out at the skate park, and Zoe, who talks about her relationship to community filtered through social media and the kind of impact that's had in her life. But it's interesting what you're saying there about slices in time, because I was thinking about the title, of course, Our Time, and you know, everyone who's in New York is still there. It's still everybody's time. But there is a sense, isn't there, where youth, you know, when we talk about youth in a place, that's our period, you know, we'll refer to maybe our teenage years or our 20s as, that was my time, that was my scene. I'd like to talk to you a little bit about that thing about aging, really, and in relation to thinking about your time in a place.
I mean, there's nothing, you know, I think that, I don't know really what to say. I mean, you know, it's, I don't have any wish to be young again, you know. I think the world we're living in now, it's changing rapidly, and it's, things are kind of much more serious in some ways in terms of what we're going to do to survive, you know, in every way. You know, in terms of like the way capitalism has become so voracious, and the way global warming is affecting, you know, it's very obvious now. It's not like there's no getting away from it, you know. So we're going to have to make some decisions, you know what I mean, about what kind of world we want to live in. that idea is implied there, sort of thing. Yeah. So I mean, I'm not going to survive forever. Nobody is. So what, you know?
I think what's very kind of not just enlightening but inspiring about your time, that time, our time, is many things, but specifically I think about you guys finding this space, this communal space within an actual space that others might have seen as abject, you know, that wasn't a place that was completely neglected, derelict, there's no money, and yet something so creative, so energetic, so forward thinking, so playful came out of it.
Well, I know, but people at that time, you know, in the 70s were living in quite, you know, rough squats here as well. I mean, it wasn't just in America, you know, because I lived here too, you know, when I came back. I mean, New York, I suppose, I mean, at that time it was very special in the sense that the city was completely broke and the middle classes had moved out and rents were very low, so you could live for next to nothing and you could have a small job and survive, and there was an incredible energy, an incredible sort of thing going on, particularly with music, but it was also with theatre, with dance, with performance art, with art. It was very alive, and all different kinds of music. There was jazz, there was downtown, all sorts. And also there was a lot of people that were listening at that time to older music from the 60s, because you could get all these secondhand, everyone wore everything secondhand, everything was recycled, furniture, clothes, you get all these records on the street. So I was like listening to all this music that I sort of heard some of, but you know, that was kind of very important, I think. And that, some of that music, like early, like say, just name one song, I don't know, like people like Surf, Dwayne Eddy, or Link Ray, or Question Mark and the Mysterians, because I use that song in one of my films, of course, with no clearance, but I have it in one of my early films. There's no such thing as clearance then, in our world. Yeah, that music had an influence on punk sounds, you know, the kind of rawness of it, you know, yeah. So there was music, and of course I was listening, yeah, whatever, anyway. The music had a very, was very important, because it was very much do-it-yourself. People weren't trained necessarily in how to play instruments, and we kind of took off from that in terms of making films, because I didn't have training in how to make films. I just did it in a very low way, you know, doing the editing at home on my kitchen table, a little thing, you know, very small camera. But it was fantastic, because we were able to show the films, and other people, I found another group of people who were also making these films, just like sticking them together with tape, you know, to make, and they had sound. The great thing was these films had sound. Super 8 with a soundtrack, a little magnetic track along the edge of the film, which these films are still played today, and some of the sound is fantastic, and it's kind of rough, but it's kind of great because it's rough, because all these other sounds from the street and sirens and people calling out come into it, you know, it's not filtered, so it's quite alive. It sounds alive. It sounds much more alive than the 16-year-old films that I heard at the time, very fresh or something. And of course, film, Super 8 film, is so tiny, each frame, you know, the size of your little finger, is survives, you know, it doesn't turn into snow like video does, you know.
Yeah.
So it really is great material.
Yeah, and I think actually you talk about sound there, you know, your affinity with and close listening, your sense of rhythm really does come across immediately in the film. Again, to think back to the opening sequence, how the sounds of the cities, you know, build and build to become almost a track, and then there's sequences where we've got kind of intense periods of sound or music and everything just drops.
Martin Wheeler composed the music for this film, the new music, and also would have done a lot of the wild track. I mean, there was some recording sound, but he did other sounds off the street, and he specializes in manipulating that, you know, wild track, so that you can't tell sometimes if it's music or if it's wild track, you know, there's that going on in some parts of the film. Yeah.
I would like to open up for questions in the audience if anyone has one. Rachel?
Well,
I was just intrigued by Lydia Lunch's appearance at the end, because, like, in your early films, she's such a powerful presence, and she's a really powerful presence here, but she's dealt with very differently to all the other people in your milieu, and I just wondered,
was that pragmatic, or was that a kind of aesthetic decision, or
a bit of both?
And a decision to do with, Lydia isn't the kind of one just to hang out like that. She sort of keeps herself apart from, you know, she's particular way of hanging out with people, and she wouldn't want to do it. Anyway, I never even asked her. I thought, now how will Lydia be in this film if I can persuade her to be in it? It has to be something a bit different, you know, so I decided maybe it should be some kind of performance, which she does a lot of, just that kind of political talks and things, and talks and films. And so, you know, she had some texts. She agreed to do it. She was hard to catch because she's on tour a lot. She really was tired when she arrived there that day, you know, just back from Europe. So I was lucky to catch her just in that week, you know. Yeah. Yeah, I know it is. She is really powerful. She's amazing, I think.
So in relation to that, actually, I'd like to pick up on something we were talking about earlier, about how a lot of the characters in the film, of course, featured in your earlier work, but this the structure of the documentary, of course, is quite different in relation to how you filmed with them. And I wonder, would you say a bit about that? Because I know it was quite collaborative in some ways, what happened in this piece.
Yeah, well, it is a little bit more like it's a kind of experimental type documentary, but it's obviously made to maybe have a slightly wider reach of the audience, right? So, you know, I was kind of concerned not to make something too conventional, because it actually started out being a bit sort of stiff and conventional at the start, and Declan was saying to me, "Are you sure you want to do that?" So, he was great, you know. And I know him
from your camera.
Yeah, I know him from many years ago. He used to live in Ireland. We used to work together before he started doing camera work for films. So I was very lucky that he did that, you know. Plus, he knew all my old work, so that helped. He wanted to create a style that matched the way I film, you know. Which he's great at handheld stuff.
Yes.
Yeah. So what was the question? Was I going to say?
He did.
Yeah.
No, well, in relation to, I suppose, the conversations around with people in the film, you know, about, let's say, I suppose, the kind of formality of the interview, but then you make it informal because you're in their space, your shoes are off, there's a lot of walking around in domestic spaces, and I wonder how much was, you know, just came about organically.
We just have a break for coffee, and Declan would be still shooting, and it was great. We decided if that happened, we would do that, because just having people sitting down talking, you know, me, and I'm kind of keeping slightly out of it anyway, just don't seem very much of me, but we figured out as we went along how to do it, you know. And we had conversations on Skype about what we might talk about in advance, and it wasn't like, well, we're going to talk about this and this and this, but something, maybe a little bit of that, you know, that maybe bring it into it. But it was people brought it in their own way, in their own time, or they didn't, you know, because, say, take Felice talking about her parents and then going to the Philippines, that was her. She wanted to bring that story into the film, you know.
That's wonderful. Yeah.
So there were things like that, you know.
Yeah. And it's I thought it was really important you included that there was a real sense of there's so many histories and people that people were bringing to the community. Mm-hmm. You know, it was like all of the 20th century was in there, from the Western world, all over Europe, you know, the States, loads of life experiences that people brought to their relationships with each other. Anyway, before I keep talking, anyone else have a question? There's a microphone there so everyone can hear you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just there from what you said at the end about the
one of the people in it talking about her parents in the Philippines, and then sort of linking that back to an earlier part of the film where somebody said, we come to New York and we can be who we want to be, we can be anonymous, and you know, coming from small towns, etc. You know, I just thought that contrast was really good, because it was almost like people kind of easing themselves into be, I mean, I know this is not in reality, but it's a nice contrast, people easing themselves into revealing themselves and revealing their history after having said, we come here as anonymous people. And I suppose that was connected with the linkage that you had with all of them as friends. There's a tremendous vibrancy there. That's really good.
They were very generous. There was a great trust there with me, you know, with them talking to me, and yeah. So,
Bernard? Vivienne, congratulations, and Kokardikasat on both the movie. It was brilliant, really inspirational, and your award. I lived in New York from the mid-70s until the early 90s. But I was immersed in the AIDS crisis in the 80s. But the women you brought to us here, I mean, they're the kind of women I would love to have had as my teachers in the convent in Ennis, where I come from. I mean, my gosh, like, these women are, you know, made of steel in the very best sense of the word. I mean, I don't know how you found them. You're so blessed to have had such friends. I presume they're all still alive. I would want them to talk to me about life, about death, about love, about freedom. I just want to thank you and congratulate you for bringing them into our lives and giving us the gift of yours and their freedom.
Thank you. It's wonderful.
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was great. I was struck by something you said about there were other places like this, like London in the 70s and 80s. And I've been in New York, and I've lived in London in squats and co-ops and things. And I'm just sort of wondering, what about now? Do you think... Because it was a very productive time, and it was cheap, and people could live. How do you think something parallel to that is happening now, and where and how? Just your thoughts on that. Because so seeing New York, it's so expensive now, and London is so expensive now. This area we're in now, you know, what was really cheap, you know, in the 70s. Nobody wanted to live here, even later than that. So I'm just wondering about... then and now, and
yeah, I think the way things have become much more difficult in terms of just living your life, your daily life. We are forced to work much more. We spend so much more time sitting in front of the computer for hours. I spend hours in the computer every day. You know, I mean, just because you have to do this and you have to do that and you have to pay bills, whatever you're doing, and you start to think, my God, I'm becoming a slave to this machine. You know, so I'm more and more on screens as well. So I think we really have to watch out how we're living. You know, we need a break from that. For otherwise, we'll just go crazy. You know. But I also think that the way things are designed is that, I mean, as we know, the world's become much more unequal. You know, it's like very, very wealthy people and very much people hardly getting paid anything at all, and no contracts and everything else. That's the kind of world we're in now. Amazon, those kind of companies. And if there are places that we can go and live, I'm sure there are, but it'd be far away from here. I mean, I think Berlin for a while may have been a place before. It's kind of changed now, I think, and, you know, it's more like here, but I don't know exactly where, but maybe Estonia, which we know. I don't really know. But I'm sure there are places in Africa or somewhere.
Well, it's... let's say that.
Hello, Vivienne. I'm back.
Hi.
I really enjoyed your film, and I wanted to ask you, how do you see foreigners, the audience in America, here in England and in France, the response from the people of France you're showing this film?
Yeah, well, I don't really know yet, Leonta, because it hasn't been shown very much, you know. I mean, actually, it's the festival thing is crazy. You need to know people in the festivals to get into the festivals, and I don't know these people. And they take people's money, and it's actually quite a scandal, because they select almost everything that they show in these festivals, it seems like to me. And they take all these submissions from people, and don't even get back to you to say, like, sorry, we're not able to take... don't even do that, just take your money. So, but I think the film will get shown somewhere in its own way, you know, it will... I think this is a film that has a life, you know, so it will get shown. Just hope there's somebody here, maybe, can give me a script. I would like to get it. I think it will, you know. But the festival thing, I tell you, I wouldn't bother. Unless you know somebody who's selecting, I wouldn't bother with the festivals.
We have never met before this evening. It's true. A hand up at the back.
I won't say anything about festivals.
No.
I wanted to.
I don't mind this one, but.
Thanks very much.
I don't know. I
wanted to ask you about. I'm thinking about the type of spaces that people inhabit within the film. There are there are places which are. I mean, in the time when you lived there previously, the spaces are often, you know, they're run down or they're squats or, and a lot of the times there's rooftop spaces and there are things which are sort of away from the hubbub of the city. And I think your the way that you deliberately not shot the street level, like the people in the city, a lot of times is really interesting. And so it's made me think about how the conditions that we find ourselves in sometimes are responsible for bursts of creativity, and I wondered if you had any thoughts on that.
The conditions that are around us, you mean?
Yeah.
Is that what you're saying? The condition that how does that impact on whether there's going to be activity in terms of creativity? Is that what you mean? Something like that?
Yeah.
And, well, New York was conducive to. It was just a special time, really, and for those reasons that the main thing is that people had time off, because you didn't have to be working all the time to pay your rent the way people do now. The rents were very, very low, and you just could get by with this. Anyway, there were hardly any jobs. You could get by with a small job, and you'd have loads of time off to do other things. You could explore what was happening, and there was lots of things happening. And you could start making things yourself, like whether it be music or whatever, you could get involved in other things. So we really do need to have time out, you know. We can't be working all the time just to pay the bills, you know what I mean? That's no way to be living. We need time to think, or just time to do nothing, you know? It's important.
Which kind of takes us back to the title. Our time could be owning our own time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, what's really precious as well, I think what really comes across is the time and space to build relationships and to make play and creativity part of that relationship, to collaborate. And that's where something new happens. So I suppose in relation to Raid.
I won't be able to find my words, but it's something about, I think it's a really crucial, important thing about becoming a robot and becoming a robot for others, where you're not even being paid. But actually that's what's happening in our sort of system, where we're actually, our time is being taken up that we might believe is a kind of leisure, but actually we're sort of becoming robots, you know. So to me it seemed that something in this film is opened up, it's really, really, really is really special about something that is spoken about the figures your friends who you're talking about the time. I'm just saying what I think of what he's experienced here, yeah, that it's very key, because it was a formative time and developing a creativity and a confidence that they all talk about, the women talk about very clearly, that confidence about the height of the stage. And that you actually, you said to me, you know, you of not necessarily knowing how to play something or whatever, but them to do that, the freedom for that, that's such a gift that can stay with you, to sort of to developing a confidence and just, yeah, capacities, so creativity. Yeah, so just to say that really, and I think that that's really special, and you've highlighted it there as a possibility. And it's crucial for where we are now, as I'm saying, how we're without unwittingly being employed as robots for corporations.
That would be brilliant, thank you.
Because of money, capital. Everything, it's like Windows 5, Windows 6. How come you're going to give me Windows 20? Give me it all. You know what I mean? And then I can learn through this journey of how to read and how to. But they introduce one thing that you're going to do.
Together and something, I don't know.